Gotcha.
Let's begin. Hello, judges. My name is Daniel, and I stand in strong affirmation of resolve. The illegal use of drugs ought to be treated as a matter of public health, not of criminal justice. The value that I believe should be valued high in today's debate is the value of morality, which is essentially what we ought to do. The value criteria in today's debate should be minimizing structural violence. Structural violence outweighs because there's an ethical obligation to address it from Ansel 17. There are many different kinds of violence. Punches, attacks, gunshots, explosions, these are kinds of interpersonal violence that we tend to hear about in the news. But the most deadliest and prevalent kind of violence exists when some groups have access to more goods, resources, and opportunities than other groups do. This violence delivers specific blows against particular bodies in particular neighborhoods. In the absence of violence, though, large numbers of Americans would still be able to live fuller and longer lives. This kind of violence is called structural violence because it is embedded in the very laws, policies, and rules that govern day-to-day life. Often, it is a product of not only racism, but gender and income inequality. That people suffer and die prematurely because of inequality is wrong. It is wrong from an ethical perspective, it is wrong from a fairness perspective, and it is wrong because we have the means to fix it. And this is exactly what my first contention is saying, and that is that the criminal justice system creates and exacerbates structural violence. Subpoint A, drug law enforcement practices and policies have had major impacts on people of color compared to whites, Drug Policy Alliance 2019. Drug law enforcement practices and sentencing policies have had profound disparate impacts on people in communities of color. By 2003, African Americans were arrested for drug law violations at a rate 238% higher than whites. African Americans and Latinos comprise two-thirds of people incarcerated for drug law violations, even though they use and sell drugs at rates comparable to whites. From this, we see that people of color face harsher sentencing from Drug Policy Alliance 2019 will continue. Misguided drug laws and draconian sentencing have produced profoundly unequal outcomes for communities of color. Research shows that prosecutors are twice as likely to pursue a mandatory minimum sentence for black people as for white people charged with the same offense. Among people who received a mandatory minimum sentence in 2011, 38% were Latino and 31% were black. B. The war on drugs has caused many structural effects to its victims, American Public Health Association, 2013. Punishment for a drug law violation is not only meted out by the U.S. criminal justice system, but also perpetuated by policies denying child custody rights, voting rights, employment, business loans, trade licensing, student aid, public housing, and other public assistance to people with criminal convictions. Even if a person does not face jail time or prison time, a drug conviction record often imposes a lifelong ban on many aspects of social, economic, and political life. Such exclusions create a permanent second-class citizenship for millions of people, and as the war on drugs itself, quote, the war on drugs translates to a war on people of color in terms of their overall health and well-being. Sub-1T is that the criminal justice system structurally impedes the public health model from the American Public Health Association 2014. Public health approaches offer effective and evidence-based responses, but some of the most effective interventions are not currently allowed in the United States due to outdated drug laws, attitudes, and stigma. A criminal justice response is ineffective and leads to other public health problems. Public funds, for example, are routinely prioritized for drug law enforcement instead of proven HIV strategies. Intention two is that the criminal justice approach fails. Subpoint A, across the globe, criminal justice fails to serve drug use. Clark 2017, globally, at any time, there are over 30 million individuals being detained and released in the community each year. However, there is now a considerable body of evidence indicating that punishment, including imprisonment, provides neither deterrence nor rehabilitation, and that the effects on crime reduction are minimal even in countries with high rates of incarceration. Relapse and reoffense are usual after release from prison. In the United States, for example, drug use relapse rates, even among those who participate in prison-based programs, are more than 80%, and in New South Wales, 84% of heroin-dependent inmates were re-imprisoned within 2 years of release. These high rates confirm that most drug offenders do not seek treatment while in prison, nor are they being referred to treatment on release. Subpoint B is that the neglect of drug abusers in the criminal justice system significantly increases the risk of overdose upon release. Lancet Commission 16. Multiple studies confirm that the period soon after release from prison is a time of very high overdose risks. Men in the first 2 weeks after their release from prison were 29 times more likely to die of overdose as the men of the same age in the general population. And women in the first 2 weeks after release from prison were 69 times more likely to die. We see the global war on drugs has failed globally to treat individuals suffering from drug abuse and keep individuals unable to rehabilitate in society, with 80% failing to recidivate in the United States and 84% in New South Wales failing as well. Contention three is that a public health approach is the best approach. So point A, drug use is a public health issue, American Public Health Association 2017. The 2016 United Nations General Assembly Special Session on Drugs, unanimously approved by 193 member states, has recognized, quote, drug addiction as a complex, multifactorial health disorder characterized by chronic and relapsing nature that is preventable and treatable and not the result of moral failure or criminal behavior. From this, we see that the criminal justice approach fails to understand the nuances of recovery and addiction. Lantiego Williams, 16. 21 million Americans currently suffer from addiction, and scores of those Americans were among the 11 million admitted to local and county jails last year. University of California Irvine criminologist Mona Lynch agrees the criminal justice system is not the place to treat addiction. That, quote, relying on the criminal law to be the stick that keeps addicts in line is not responsive to the public health problem or to the person's health problem. From this, we see that the threat of punishment is insufficient and that we need treatment. This comes from Kelly 18. The threat of punishment, or actually experiencing punishment, often takes a back seat compared to the positive response in the brain to using drugs. This is why a public health approach in the United States would be more effective than a criminal justice system approach. This is from Lancet 2001. Study after study has shown that treatment and prevention help far more people at far less cost. And for these reasons, I urge you to affirm today's debate, and I stand ready for cross-examination.
Judges ready?
All ready, yes.
Does the punishment related to a crime vary according to severity?
I'd say yes.
Okay. And so in your contention, when you talk a lot about current problems with the criminal justice system, why can't these problems be addressed through reform? Why does that mandate a removal of criminal justice from illegal drug use considerations?
I think there's a two-pronged response there. Firstly, I'm not saying that we should get rid of the entire criminal justice system. That doesn't make any sense. What I am saying, though, is in today's resolution, we're weighing the two worlds of what should the response be that is elicited from when someone uses drug use. I'm not necessarily saying I need to upheaval the entire criminal justice system.
But
all I'm saying is that public health is crucial here.
But wouldn't you agree that one of your burdens under this resolution is not only to prove that illegal drug use ought to be treated as a public health matter, but also that illegal drug use ought not to be treated as a criminal justice matter?
I would agree, that's true. I'm just arguing that I'm not arguing for the entire removal of the entire criminal justice system.
From illegal drug use considerations?
When it comes to the illegal use of drugs, yes. The response from that illegal use of drugs should not be criminal justice. Instead, it should be public health.
So in your case, you focus a lot on structural violence. What about violence done to non-drug users?
I'd say that violence done to non-drug users is something that can essentially be solved in both worlds. Like, if a drug dealer is selling drugs, that's something that I can still address because that's not use, that would be distribution.
But if there's violence to non-drug users, doesn't that mandate that there ought to be a consequence for that violence?
I'd say that if a drug abuser in and of itself, like, murders someone, then yes, I feel like we should prosecute him for that murder. But if a drug abuser is just abusing drugs, then I feel like we still need to elicit a response from public health to solve that issue.
Does the prevalence of drugs in community increase the preponderance and the predisposition for violence and other negative health effects?
I'd say that when it comes to people being addicted to drugs, often a stigma is related with it as if they're violent, specifically when it comes to the black community. I don't think that's true. I do believe that when there are higher amounts of drugs, or whether it be with gangs or cartels, obviously violence increases, but inherently just because you abuse drugs doesn't mean you're violent.
So will removal of the criminal justice system from illegal drug use considerations necessarily reduce stigma? Doesn't stigma also emanate from culture? So will removing the criminal justice system necessarily solve the problem?
Well, I'd say that there's a lot of nuances for stigma specifically, but I feel like a main component of stigma comes from the stigmatization of drug abuse, and that comes from the criminal justice system of it being an imprisonable crime.
What constitutes an unjust punishment?
I said that when it comes to something being unjust, it means that the punishment doesn't fit the crime. I mean, obviously, like, I'm not sure what you're relating this to, but if we're just talking in generalities, I feel like that would be the fair response.
Do you believe that the law exists to promote safety in society?
I'd say that that's why laws were created.
So you would say that punishment is simply a means to that greater end?
Not necessarily. I'd say that laws, while were generally created to help public issues, I'd say that often maybe laws are not exactly the best. I mean, we see that when slavery was legal. But I feel like just because laws are meant to protect people doesn't mean they always do that.
Okay, thank you. Judges ready? Opponent ready?
Yes.
Good evening, judges. My name is Matthew, and I will be your negative speaker for today's debate. I negate today's resolution result. The illegal use of drugs ought to be treated as a matter of public health, not of criminal justice. I would like to define public health. Public health is concerned with protecting the health of entire populations, CDC Foundation. Criminal justice system. The system in a society by which people who are accused of crimes are judged in court. Cambridge Dictionary. Furthermore, the rest of my definitions will be provided upon request. Now, judges, my value for today's debate is safety, defined by Oxford Dictionary as the condition of being protected from or unlikely to cause danger, risk, or injury. My value criterion is utilitarianism, defined by Cambridge Dictionary as the system of thought that states that the best action or decision in a particular situation is the one that brings most advantages to the most people. Observation 1. In order for you to affirm today's resolution, the affirmative has two burdens. First, to prove that illegal drug use ought to be considered a matter of public health, and second, to prove that illegal drug use ought not to be considered a matter of criminal justice. If the affirmative cannot uphold both burdens, then it will actually fail to convince you as to why you should affirm today's resolution. And thus, I believe my opponent in the last cross-examination has agreed to this burden. Therefore, we will proceed with contention 1. Removing criminal justice from illegal drug use will increase drug use. Decriminalizing and/or legalizing drugs will increase their use. According to America's Quarterly, our long experience with two legal substances, alcohol and tobacco, demonstrates that legalization increases society's acceptance, availability, use, and associated costs. Alcohol and tobacco cause hundreds of thousands more deaths per year than all illegal drugs combined, in part because their use is more widespread. In the Netherlands, the promotion of coffee shops, places where cannabis is sold, caused the rate of regular marijuana use among 18 to 20-year-olds to double. In America, there are some 60 million smokers, up to 20 million alcoholics and alcohol misusers, but only around 6 million illegal drug addicts. If illegal drugs were easier to obtain, this figure would rise. Increased drug usage will decrease the safety for society as a whole, given the negative health effects related to illegal drug usage. Contention 2. Criminal justice upholds utilitarianism by keeping the public safe. The illegal use of drugs is illegal for a reason. It harms public safety. According to the Ted Knopf Foundation, in 2009 to 2010, Duma found that more than 70% of those detained by police for violent assaults in King's Cross, Sydney, tested positive to at least one drug type. This is because psychostimulants like methamphetamine can induce psychosis, which while temporary can involve delusions and hallucinations leading to hostile behavior, thus showing that there is a causal link. As for nonviolent offenders, a 2007 article from the Center on Addiction reports, sensible use of courts, punishment, and prisons can encourage misusers to enter treatment. After all, see the arrest as an opportunity and require the teenager to be screened, have any needed treatment. Furthermore, Sweden offers an example of a successful restrictive drug policy. Faced with rising drug use in the 1990s, the government tightened drug control, stepped up police action, mounted a national action plan, and created a national drug coordinator. The result? Drug use is just a third of the European average. Hence, considering criminal justice and drug policy leads to greater safety, thereby promoting the well-being and utilitarian aspect of society as a whole. Now, I will go on to address my opponent's case. Let us first of all begin with my opponent's framework of morality and value criterion of minimizing structural violence. And the main qualms that I have with his framework is that 1, it is too general, and 2, I believe that his value criterion is too narrow. Let's start with the fact that his value is too general. First of all, morality implies that you are using some sort of moral code. After all, different religions and different societies have different versions of what it means to be moral. So I would like to ask my opponent, what sort of moral framework is he using to specifically evaluate morality, as that can be a very subjective term. Move on to his value criterion of minimizing structural violence. But I believe that we ought to not only look at structural violence in today's resolution, as that is not the only type of violence happening in society today. Structural violence has its place, but I also believe we ought to examine the violence being done to non-drug users and to members of the community as a whole. And the reason why is my framework accounts for everyone in society. Let's look at safety. Safety defines the type of societal welfare we ought to look at in today's debate. Utilitarianism is important because government is not just obligated to a certain group of individuals, government is obligated to everyone, and thus it is the responsibility of government to meet that standard. The Constitution doesn't just say, I the person, it says, we the people, and it takes this view of society as a whole, and that is why we must have societal considerations manufactured in it. Let us first of all address his first contention about exacerbating violence. And I would like to point out that the majority of his evidence in this first contention is related to the United States. And I would like to emphasize that I do not have to defend the status quo of criminal justice. It is the view of the negative that we can consider reforms to be made to address problems like systemic racism and discrimination. We acknowledge that is a problem. But is the answer to remove criminal justice from illegal drug use considerations? Absolutely not. When you look at the fact in our society, there are many other institutions in the United States that also suffer from racism and discrimination. But does that mean we remove those institutions from certain considerations? The military for many years was that way until 1948 when President Truman desegregated the armed forces. That is an example of how we can take that step without having to throw out the baby with the bathwater. Let us then examine the structural violence done to victims. Now, once again, I believe that reform is the answer to the criminal justice approach because, once again, you need laws to maintain public safety and order. Now, moving on to his subpoint C about how this impedes public health. And I would like to ask my opponent this question. Is treatment exclusive to public health? Treatment can also be executed under the criminal justice system, as we have seen with the current use of drug courts, where 75% of graduates have remained arrest-free, and shows that really there are cases where the evidence does contradict my opponent's examples. Let us then examine his second point, which is that criminal justice fails. And I want to point out, first of all, that I did mention the example of Sweden in my case on how not every country's approach to criminal justice has to be like the United States. For instance, I do not have to defend mandatory minimums. We can talk about softening the amount of punishment done if it advances safety, which is my value. But does softening necessarily mean that we completely remove the aspect of punishment and certain uses of illegal drugs? Absolutely not. And that is why we ought to consider this value approach in today's debate, because safety allows us to have some nuance in this approach. Let us then examine the fact that public health is the best approach. And once again, judges, we can see that although public health can exist, this does not mandate the complete removal of criminal justice, which is the second burden of my opponent. Thank you.
Okay, so let's look at the top of the flow. Your value is safety, correct?
Yes.
And your valuation is utilitarianism.
Yes.
So by doing the most amount of good, you create the most amount of safety. Is that kind of what you're going for?
Yeah.
Okay, so would you say that addressing drug abuse is a key issue for both of us in today's debate?
Yes.
Okay. And moving on from that, your observation one is that the affirmative role has two burdens, right? Specifically proving that public health worsens and that criminal justice system fails.
Mm-hmm. Okay. You agree to that?
Right, I would agree with that. But specifically, you keep making these claims that when it comes to safety, I can't solve for that. Why specifically in the affirmative role can't I prosecute someone that murders someone even though they also use drugs?
But understand, why should you have to wait until that actually occurs? If we do know that this drug does pose a threat to society, shouldn't we regulate that kind of behavior? We already do that with certain uses of other substances, such as alcohol. We make certain uses of alcohol illegal for that very reason.
So you're saying that the best way to solve for people committing crimes while inebriated would be to address drug abuse? Is that kind of what you're saying?
I'm saying that, look, we can look at treatment, but it is unrealistic to suggest that we can completely remove criminal justice considerations in matters of illegal drug use.
Okay, let's look at your second contention. You're kind of, and this is kind of something you advocate for, you advocate for reform, and I believe specifically you advocate for drug courts. Is this kind of your ideal situation on how we can reform the criminal justice
system? Look, I'm not specifically saying that all of it should be drug courts. I'm just saying this out there as a measure that could possibly work. It's just an example of how criminal justice can also incorporate treatment.
Okay, and moving on from that, your second contention talks about how the criminal justice system keeps the public safe, and you say that drug abusers are violent. Is this the majority of users?
Well, I'm not saying that all of them are violent, but just because they aren't
okay, statistically, is that the majority?
Well, it depends on what statistics you're looking at and from what place.
Do you provide any statistics in your case saying that drug abusers violently are the majority?
Not in my case, but just because they aren't the majority actively, we have to understand that just because it does not always result in violence doesn't mean it can't do so in the future. Does alcohol abuse always result in drunk driving? Not necessarily, but that means we still regulate certain uses of alcohol.
So if you're saying that drug abusers that are violent isn't the majority, then how can your value criterion about utilitarianism be upheld when that is specifically focusing on the majority?
Well, let's look at this. What we have to see is what benefits society as a whole. If we have less drug addicts in the street, that will actually advance what truly matters in today's debate.
Okay, what's the, if you could give me the specific piece of evidence that you show where, like, the drug users are violent?
Okay, for the case, okay.
Yeah, okay, just after that. And then finally, your B is that courts put people in treatment. Is this where you kind of go for people are being forced into treatment? That's kind of your drug court advocacy?
Drug court advocacy means that we are helping these people gain access to the treatment while also preventing them from being a danger to society and a danger to themselves.
Okay. Thank you. And if you could, whenever you get the chance. And I'll be running for it. Specifically, when you talk about your study, which keeps the public safe and how drug abuse is going on. Yeah, okay. Judges, I'll just be going there. Opponent, ready?
Yeah.
Let's begin. So starting at the top of the negative flow, my opponent gives you this value of safety and the value criterion of utilitarianism. Now I ask my opponent in cross-examination, is addressing drug abuse a key issue in today's debate? And of course he agrees. Now why this is crucial is because the only way to truly solve and address drug abuse is to actually affirm. And I'll go through when I go through the rest of his case. But firstly, I'd like to point out a couple flaws with this framework. You see, he proposes that utilitarianism and safety must go in tandem, but yet his statistics don't prove that he's actually helping the majority. The only case that he can prove that safety is being harmed is when it comes from violent drug offenders that commit crimes against other people. Here's his statistics. It specifically looks at Australia, and it says that there was a 37% of people arrested for violent crimes that also tested positive. So let's say that my opponent solves for every single percent that he proposed to be. That is still not the majority. The people who are being helped isn't even his own framework. Why this is crucial is because whenever he says that by doing the most amount of good to achieve safety, that is not true. He is not helping the most amount of people, specifically because that's not the majority. And when we look at decreasing structural violence, I will prove why that is greater than specifically focusing on safety. But let's look at the rest of his case. My opponent's observation is that I have two burdens. I would agree, and now I'd like to prove to you that I not only show that the public health model is greater, but the criminal justice system fails and will never work. Here's why. His first contention is that the criminal justice system removal will increase drug use, and he essentially says that many people use drugs. I believe he references coffee shops and those kinds of things. Specifically, that isn't necessarily true. You don't really hear the statistics here for why in removing the criminal justice system increased drug uses. Also, I'd like you to take note that I'm not advocating for this mass removal of the criminal justice system that my opponent is saying I am. He's making it sound quite apocalyptic. That's not true. The criminal justice system exists in both worlds. The only difference is the response that is elicited from the illegal use of drugs differs world to world. Now, the main other argument he makes, and this is the crux of his case, is that he can reform the criminal justice system, and he advocates for a coerced version, specifically drug courts. And I'd like to specifically respond to that. Quote, meta-analysis shows that drug courts do not improve outcomes. This is from Verb 16. Of an initial 430 potential studies identified, evidence does not, on the whole, suggest improved outcomes related to compulsory treatment approaches, and while some studies suggest potential harms. This is again also said by the Drug Policy Alliance 17 that says studies of drug court success are inconclusive. On balance, drug courts appear to be no more effective than voluntary treatment in terms of treatment engagement, retention, completion, and reduction in drug use. What the Drug Policy Alliance and Word et al. 16 are saying is that his proposed reforms don't actually solve and address drug use. Here's why it's crucial. My opponent will come up here and say that actually I'm not talking about drug courts, I'm talking about this thing. This is why the Werbel 16 evidence is so crucial. It's not saying drug courts, it's saying coercive treatment. This is any form that he proposes to propose is always going to be coercive, and that's why it's always going to fail. And this flows into the affirmative side of today's bit. When we look at my friend gives you two responses. Firstly, he says that my value of morality is too general. That's not true. The resolution itself says the illegal use of drugs ought essentially means morality. Why this is important is because morality is what we truly should be looking at in today's debate. It's the perfect outcome, and that's what we ought to do. And this flows right into my value criterion of decreasing structural violence. You see, my opponent says that decreasing structural violence is too narrow. That is not true. Look at the specific evidence I provide. You see, as much as he'd like to say that structural violence isn't that big of a deal, that's not true. In fact, it is greater than the violence that he proposed to support, specifically because of the back half of the card that he drops. There is an ethical obligation to address structural violence, and that overcomes, that's in the Ansel 17 card, any form of violence he proposes to solve. In my first contention about how the criminal justice system increases structural violence, my opponent's only claim is that, again, he's not arguing status quo, he can have drug courts. Specifically, this is not true. I've responded to this, completely turned this argument. Now, the only other thing he can say is that it isn't a brain disease, and that's why it shouldn't be public health. I'd like you to understand that I provided four specific pieces of evidence for why this is false. Let's go through a couple of them. Kelly 18 empirically proves that punishment is false. It will never work. Lancet 2001 empirically proves that it has a lot to do with public health, and the rest of them are simple as that. For these reasons, I urge you to vote affirmative in today's debate. Thank you.
Judges, given that I used 2 minutes last time, I will use the remainder 2 minutes starting. Judges, ready? Point ready.
Yes.
So judges, let us first of all begin with the framework debate. My main qualm with morality being too general is that he does not specifically provide the link between morality and reducing structural violence, as his moral code is just simply too vague. But even if you buy that, let's look at structural violence. I believe that structural violence, however, is not the only type of violence out there in the community. Even if you buy my opponent's argument that it is a big problem, and I do agree with it, you first of all also have to consider that society cannot always only consider that. There are other forms of violence out there that we need to be cognizant and aware of. Let us then examine the issue of safety. By addressing structural violence, we can actually promote safety in the long term, and that is best done through a balanced approach of both criminal justice and treatment programs. Let us then examine my opponent's attack on utilitarianism. He did not dispute the fact that government is obligated to society as a whole, and since government is obligated to society as a whole, it mandates that we not only examine structural violence, but we also look at the violence done to non-drug users, as government has this obligation. Now, first of all, let us tackle the issue of violence. Just because something doesn't occur 100% of the time doesn't mean that there isn't a causal link between two things. For example, certain illegal uses of alcohol may not always result in a drunk driving accident, but we do know that you cannot have drunk driving without alcohol. We do know that alcohol causes an increased preponderance and predisposition to these certain types of behaviors, which is why we make it illegal, these certain uses. And that is what I'm saying with drugs, that by making certain uses of drugs illegal, that is what we are effectively doing. We're not talking about legal uses of drugs, but we're talking about drugs like cocaine, heroin, meth, LSD. These are drugs that have shown to cause individuals a greater propensity to violence. And in addition, a Reuters article stated that data shows that on average about 23% of violent crimes and property crimes, including home burglaries, were committed by people who tested positive for at least one of 10 illegal drugs, including heroin and methamphetamines. This is certainly the case. Now, how does this tie into utilitarianism? First of all, by criminalizing certain behaviors of drugs, we can, of course, deter and reduce access to uses like this. Furthermore, let us also look that the drug users themselves benefit from a criminal justice approach, because when we use treatment, we don't let them roam freely in the streets, but we instead use an option that protects them from others and protects them from themselves and reduces their ability to harm others in that effect. So that is the essential crux of today's debate. Let us also examine the fact that in Italy, where personal possession of a few doses of drugs like heroin has generally been exempt from criminal sanction, Italy has one of the highest rates of heroin addiction in Europe, with more than 60% of AIDS cases there attributable to intravenous drug use. This is an example of why removing all restrictions on the criminal justice side of things actually doesn't lead to positive outcomes. Now, he might try to tell you that he's not advocating for removing all rules, but let us keep in mind his burden, which he agreed to in today's resolution, which is to not treat this as a matter of criminal justice. I would like to emphasize that once more. Furthermore, I believe that fundamentally speaking, regulating certain usage of drugs is just, because what does the law exist to do? The law exists to promote safety, and that is the entire premise of the social contract. And we regulate certain items and behaviors that pose a threat to society. We have shown that drug use does pose a threat to society, and that society has an interest in regulating certain behaviors. I'm not saying that we should ban all drugs, but I'm saying regulate the behaviors that have shown to be false. And in regards to structural violence, let us also consider that he did not really address the racism attack I labeled on his last case, in which I pointed out that many other institutions in the United States suffer from systemic racism, but does that mean we completely remove those institutions? Is that the mandated solution? Removing those institutions from certain considerations? Absolutely not. And that is why I believe that my opponent is simply going too far in this approach. He also disagrees about the fact of drug courts, but I would like to point out that drug courts, first of all, save $27 for every $1 invested. Secondly, the evidence proves that the main problem with drug courts is not something inherent in the system itself, but rather it's due to a lack of resources inherent in the system. And so if the problem is a lack of resources, then the solution is simply a redirectment of the current situation in terms of resources, not necessarily the gutting of the entire drug court system. But furthermore, my opponent does not understand the fact that what we need to this complex issue is not a simplistic solution, but rather one that is also nuanced in its approach. And that is what we consider in today's debate. I would like to reaffirm my value and value criterion and explain why it is the superior one in today's debate. First of all, we must look at what society is obligated to do. Society is obligated to promote the general welfare as stated in the Constitution, and specifically in illegal drug use considerations that need to promote safety. The question then becomes which side can best do that. And when we look at cases where we have disregarded criminal justice, which is one of his burdens to uphold, you actually have seen heroin addiction increase, as I mentioned with my Italy evidence. You also ignored the serious negative externalities associated with drug use. That is not safety. And in addition, who's to say that we cannot incorporate treatment within the criminal justice system? The criminal justice system has plenty of that right now, and we simply need to add more resources if my opponent really wants to make this more efficient. Secondly, utilitarianism forces us to adopt a view that is greater than structural violence alone. And that is why we must take into account other forms of violence as well. And when we use utilitarianism, we are also taking into account the interests of non-drug users. By criminalizing certain uses of drugs, such as making it illegal for alcohol for a driver to drink over the legal limit, for instance, or underage minors to drink alcohol. When we do that, we ultimately advance the interests of the user and society as a whole. Thank you.
Three voters for why I believe affirmative takes today's round. Ready? So because the negative side nuances of drug abuse and recovery, I am proud to affirm today's resolution. The first voter for why I believe affirmative should win is simply the framework debate. Now, you're hearing a lot of arguments against the decrease of structural violence from my opponent, but unfortunately, he essentially dropped in his second speech, and he could never respond to it, the back burner of the Ansel 17 card, which is the reason to prefer decrease of structural violence. It empirically says that we must address structural violence because we have an ethical obligation to address it over all other forms of violence. Why this is crucial is because every other form of violence he advocates for not only is not the majority, but still should not be put over a decrease of structural violence, which he himself says that is a major issue. And when we look at the other side of the framework debate, simply put, the contradiction between him trying to help the most amount of people, but yet the only instance he can say of security being put in jeopardy is 37%, and then the new piece of evidence he provides is only specifically 23%. This is definitely not the utilitarianistic approach that my opponent says he's like to pursuing. Why this is crucial is this is a massive contradiction in his framework, and you can never wholeheartedly affirm without addressing the fact that you must decrease structural violence. Now, looking at the last two reasons for why I believe affirmative wins comes down to an observation he provides and a game that he says that we should both play. This game is that the affirmative has two burdens. One, prove that public health works, and two, prove that criminal justice system works. The fact is that these two voters and throughout today's debate have proven that I win on both burdens, and thusly, the affirmative should win the affirmative bout. Now, the second border empirically is that drug courts fail, and the negative side fails to address drug abuse. Now, my opponent kind of tries to slither out of the fact that drug courts failing by saying that it lacks resources. Here's the thing, if you give $1 million to a broken machine, you're still gonna have a broken machine. It doesn't change the fact that drug courts and any form of coercion, drug abuse, will never be able to actually solve drug abuse. That's an inherent issue with it. That's exactly what Verb 16 is saying, along with the Drug Policy Alliance 2017 is saying. This is empiric evidence that proves that drug courts will never work. Why this is important is because this is his entire linchpin. This is the only way he can advocate for a system that actually works. It's drug courts and it's coercive treatment, and that is false because of the third voter, and this is the second half of the burden. Simply put, the affirmative way is the only way to solve drug abuse. And I provide you that nuance is the main key issue here, and I give you four pieces of evidence. Let's go down those specific four pieces of evidence. Firstly, from the United Nations, 193 member states unanimously agreed that public health is something that is multifactorial disorder issue that must be addressed through public health. If you don't really like the United Nations, let's look at Kelly 18. That proves the criminal justice system cannot have a specific issue, cannot solve drug abuse, because it does not address the nuances. Let's say you don't like Kelly 18. Let's look at the third piece of evidence I provide, which is essentially Lantuega Williams 16. That proves the criminal justice system, again, fails to understand the nuances. And why is this crucial? It's because I strongly urge you to affirm today's resolution, because I'm the only one that can address drug abuse. Thank you.